Hi everyone, Dr. J here. In this lesson, I'm going to talk about the basics of what is geodesy and give you a little bit of an introduction to the field and the tools and data that are used so that you have an idea about what we'll be talking about as we go along in this class. Now, geodesy as a science is actually one of the oldest, if not the oldest, of the formal sciences. And it's the science of location, or telling where things are and how they're moving and what the position of objects is on a map, and making maps and things like that. Surveying is one aspect of geodesy. We're not going to talk too much about surveying in this class, but surveying is definitely one of the oldest of the formal sciences that there is. People have been marking out boundaries and trying to determine where their land or their empire or their property stops for hundreds and thousands of years. Now, on the website that I'm showing you, you'll also see an example of another type of geodetic data, which is from gravity. So here you see the gravity, or the geoid, variations at the scale of the whole Earth, the whole globe. And you can see some areas have higher and lower gravity. Gravity is another type of geodetic data, and there are a number of types of data that I want to talk about today. So GPS, or GNSS, that's the global positioning system, or the global navigation satellite systems. Those two terms, by the way, are used for the same thing in a sense. GPS is the US version of GNSS. So GNSS refers to all countries' systems. GPS is just the US version of this system. And of course, you all know what GPS is. It's how you tell where you are. And you have a GPS unit in your phone, you might have one in your car, or maybe you've used a handheld GPS unit. Oftentimes nowadays, watches will have GPS units in them, and they're all serving the same purpose, telling you where you are on the surface of the Earth. Now, GPS actually serves a number of other purposes. One purpose is to very accurately locate satellites in space, airplanes in the sky. One purpose that's used for scientific studies is we actually try to tell where points on the ground are located relative to one another, and how fast those points may or may not be moving. So here on the screen you see an example of a GPS station. I think this is in California or the western US somewhere. And it's literally just a pole in the ground with an antenna on top, GPS antenna, and it just sits there 365 days a year and collects data on its position. Now you might say, well, that seems kind of weird. It's just sitting there on the ground in the middle of nowhere collecting data about its position. Who is going to care about that? Well, it turns out at plate tectonic boundaries, or because of plate tectonics, many positions on the surface of the ground are actually moving. And I should say, depending on what your reference is, all points on the ground are actually moving all the time, just at a very slow rate so that you don't notice anything. Now, at plate boundaries, where two plates come together, those two plates might not be moving in the same way or in the same direction. And so we can tell that very accurately using these GPS stations. And this is what's done in California and other places around the world. And we'll talk more about that as we go on in the class. LIDAR, or light detection and ranging, is another type of geodetic data where you can make these measurements from the ground or from an airplane. And these are laser measurements. Your instrument is, say, sitting here. It sends off a laser in one direction. That laser bounces back to the instrument and gets collected as a signal. Now, LIDAR is used for a number of reasons. One scientific purpose is to make very high resolution digital elevation maps, or DEMs. So you can use LIDAR to get a much more detailed picture of topography, which perhaps you might need for studying fault scarps, or studying the slope of an area where it might have landslides in the future. So LIDAR is used for all sorts of things like that, as well as measuring vegetation growth, because you can actually differentiate between vegetation and the ground surface, and it has a number of other uses as well. INSAR, or Interferometric Synthetic Aperture Radar, is similar to LIDAR in that it's a remote measurement, but in this case, INSAR is made from a satellite, SAR satellites, or SAR sensors, and these measurements are made every so often as the satellite travels around the Earth, so that the same spot on the surface of the Earth gets imaged multiple times in time as the satellite orbits. This gives us actually a very interesting scenario where we have a whole time series of measurements of the same point on the ground, and how that point has or hasn't moved. And you can see an example on the screen. This is just showing deformation at a volcano, and I don't know what volcano this is, but a volcano, when it erupts, just before it erupts, or maybe even without erupting at all, it might have some deformation, some motion up or down as magma moves up and moves down, as pressure builds up and then gets released either through an eruption or through other means. And we can measure that very accurately using INSAR. I've already mentioned gravity. There are different types of gravity measurements, and actually gravity is used both at the very small scale, so at a field scale you might look at a particular site and measure gravity measurements at very high resolution. Or GRACE, the Gravity Recovery and Climate Experiment satellite, is used to get gravity for a very large region, actually over the whole world, at very, relatively coarse resolution, but at a global scale. GRACE is used to measure things like groundwater storage changes over the whole western US, or ice loss in Greenland or Antarctica. So these gravity measurements can be very useful because they track the motion of mass around the world, which very often is related to water motion, or the motion of water going from one place to another. Altimetry is another type of geodetic data. This is just looking at heights, and this is very important for sea level as well as for ice levels. Structure from motion, or photogrammetry, is a way that we can get three-dimensional representations of objects from two-dimensional pictures. And this can be very useful if we are, for example, if we don't have a lot of GPS stations, or if we need very high accurate positions, but we don't have the ability to get a LiDAR or get, you know, hundreds of GPS stations to put out, we can actually just have a few GPS stations and take pictures using those GPS stations to constrain where our camera is, and then we can constrain all the other points in our pictures by using those pictures and combining them with that algorithm. And then finally, there are various types of other sensors, geodetic sensors, such as strain meters and creep meters. These are all, again, sensing deformation of the ground, or the way the ground is moving, changing, the way mass is changing, and you can do this in boreholes, or you can do this on the surface of the ground, depending on the instrument. So that's an overview of different types of geodetic data. In this class, we're going to focus on a few different types. We're going to focus on GPS, or GNSS, INSAR, LiDAR, and gravity. And then we'll have one module which talks a bit about some of the other types. If you have questions about any of these types or would like to learn more, you can check out UNAVCO's website, unavco.org. You can check out the Geodesy website, or you can post a question on Piazza and ask me. And we'll be talking more about these as we go through each one of the modules.